It's my honor today to introduce my friend and colleague, renowned Wagner scholar, Dr. David Breckbill, who has been teaching at Doane College for 25 years, and this fall for 3 or 4 months, Doane University. During that time, he has touched a full generation of students, students who, like many of you, sat in these seats and other seats in this building, observing and learning from one of the greatest humans and brightest minds to have taught in our department. In my 13 years of teaching with Dr. B, I've been continually struck by the breadth and depth of his knowledge about music, and more generally about life, and really more generally about kind of everything. Additionally, his world-class musicianship has elevated so much of what we have done here, so much of the music that we've heard in this department and on this stage, student recitals, innumerable student recitals. I also am reminded of the fine musical work that the Doane Piano Ensemble Pianoforte did, many concerts on this stage. Such great memories. David's prodigious intellect and fierce commitment to scholarly pursuits will always be an example, not only to our students, but also to the other faculty who have had the privilege to work with him. In addition to his teaching, David is loyal to his family and his church, has embraced world travel and all the richness that it can bring to our mortal journey. We are grateful to you, David, for all of your service to Doane over the years. We thank you for making time and space in your life for us these past 25 years and this afternoon. We love you, sir, and we will never forget you. And we will miss you so much when you are gone. Thank you for all you've done. Please help me thank and welcome Dr. David Breckbill. Thanks.
Well, I assure you it's all downhill from here. Thank you to so many of you for making a special effort to be here. It means a lot to have me, to have you here. When it became clear that the state of my health would not permit me to teach at Doane past this semester, I asked Jay Gilbert if I would be able to give a talk to the members of the music department. He agreed, so this is that talk. One of the things that is cause for the greatest perplexity and grief for me, as I face the end of my time at Doane and the end of life in general, is that I hate to lose the many musical enthusiasms I have cultivated, the great knowledge I have amassed, the skills I have developed, and the instincts I have honed without passing them on in some meaningful way. Of course, some of all that has come through in my writing, teaching, performing, and interactions, but I still feel that I am able to leave behind only a small fraction of what I have become. This talk is far too short to rectify that situation, but I will use it to try to summarize what I see as important things I have learned in music, even as they can relate to one's extra musical life. A number of important personal landmarks took place in the first half of 1991. In January, I began teaching my first course at Doane College. In March, my son Ben was born, and in May, I submitted my PhD dissertation. At the time, we had been in Nebraska for less than 2 years and felt sure that we would be moving elsewhere soon. It thus comes as a surprise to realize that not just teaching, but teaching at Doane College has become every bit as important to my identity as having a doctorate or being Ben's father. Very soon after starting here, I moved to teaching 2 or 3 and several times 4 courses each semester. And ever since, for 20 plus years, except for 3 semesters when my wife Anita and I were on sabbatical leave in Wales, London, and India, I have kept at it, teaching probably about 120 classes here. My Doane courses have varied in subject matter, mostly music history, with others in music theory, music appreciation, jazz, and other topics. But as I look back from this vantage point, there is one trait common to all of them. It stems from some of the most powerful experiences I had as a student in college and graduate school, those occasions on which, in the course of a lecture, a professor played a musical example that unexpectedly opened new vistas for me. Since I know and am enthusiastic about so much music, I have always tried to pepper my courses with occasions on which we just listen to random music in the hope that it will impress at least one person in the class enough to follow up on a given piece and to get to know it better. In fact, let's do such an exercise right now. Here's the coda of the first movement of Beethoven's string quartet in E-flat, opus 74, nicknamed the harp, for the pizzicato effects you will hear even in this short example. What an extraordinary passage. After the music has come to a conclusion with the end of the recapitulation just before we started, this coda begins with a jumpy, unsettled figure, which is promptly calmed by the sustained lyrical texture, but not by the harmony and dynamics, which quest onward and finally break out into more serious disruption. This is the first time in the movement that the pizzicato material sounds threatening rather than orderly, while to it is added a virtuosic first violin part that seems to careen ever more nearly out of control. As momentum and tension build, lyricism again makes itself known, gradually subsuming the first violin harmonically and allowing its activity to enhance rather than to threaten. These two components together reach a hard-earned cadence, which allows more conventional and stable material to bring the movement to a close. I have two related observations to make about having presented you with this example just now. First, I fully recognize that trying to get you to be enthusiastic about this passage in this context is like trying to capture lightning in a bottle. You simply may not have been prepared, either in short-term mood or long-term musical exposure or inclination, to respond well, and it could well be that another of the thousands of random examples I could have chosen would have appealed to you more. Second, I need to remember that my own familiarity with a passage or piece simply does not translate into immediate or easy comprehension of it for you. Although it is anything but my intention to promote obsessive behavior, I would, however, like to put in a plug for what I will call serial immersive listening. What this long-term habit has looked like for me is spending months or years at a time of my recreational listening by concentrating over and over again on the same work or body of works or composer or genre. Thus, I have had clearly demarcated phases in my listening life. A Beethoven phase when I was young, a 19th century piano music phase, a Wagner phase, a Hugo Wolf phase, a jazz phase, a Mahler Seventh Symphony phase, a Sibelius phase, a Martinu phase, a Beethoven string quartet phase, and a Haydn phase have been among my most notable. Those of you who have had me as your professor in Fine Arts 104 will remember my standing assignment that you listen to a movement of Beethoven's Ninth every day in order to get to know the piece intuitively rather than just to know it about it from what we cover and discuss in class. I'm realistic enough to recognize that most of you did not do this. You regarded such an assignment as hopeless overkill. But I want you all to know that when I have been learning pieces of music, what I ask you to do is a mere fraction of what I have done. A student once discovered in our music history textbook that Wagner's cycle of four operas called Der Ring des Nibelungen takes 4 evenings and 14 hours to perform. She felt moved to ask, "Dr. Breckbill, have you ever heard the whole thing?" Only to learn that I had throughout high school made it a habit to go to bed at 7 o'clock, get up at 2, and listen to a Wagner opera or some other significant swath of music before going to school in the morning. I had heard The Ring scores of times by the time I went to college, scores more during college, and since then, as a reviewer and scholar of Wagner recordings, have heard it hundreds of more times, and so on for the other things I've listed and many others besides. Earlier, I said that I consider it sad that I can't pass on what I have learned. There's some truth to that, but I would say that my various phases, periods during which I was learning new pieces or learning them at a new level of intimacy, were some of the most vibrant of my life. It's good and satisfying to know things, but it's more exciting to be discovering and learning, since this is the process through which you make things your own. In any case, why should you consider an ongoing practice of serial immersive listening? First, you make musical friends in the form of works that thereafter remain constant points of reference in your life. The web of associations that comes from knowing many pieces well is incredibly rich. Second, if you are listening intently during this process, asking questions of what you are hearing and trying to figure it out, your listening and musical skills vastly increase. Third, if you undertake such a process from some music, you gain a sense of what is involved in getting to know other music just as well. You get an idea of what you don't know, which keeps you humble. And fourth, with increased listening skills at your disposal, your ability to make sense of music new to you upon first hearing also increases. These are, I think, strong arguments for such a practice. It makes you a better musician. But if I am honest with myself, I hear you, and even me, asking, what difference does it make if I know the Beethoven quartets like the back of my hand? Isn't this just selfish indulgence? What good does it do the world for me to know music this well? It is to that question that I turn for the remainder of this talk, although I must warn you that I will be addressing the larger question primarily in the form of a musical analogy. Of all the many important things my high school piano teacher did for me, one of those with the most lasting significance was to make sure that I heard multiple recordings of pieces I was working on seriously. I was perhaps innately attuned in a way that others are not to getting the most out of such an experience, but I found it incredibly illuminating and perplexing to hear four performances of, say, Chopin's Second Ballade and to find such remarkable differences in expressive impact from one to the other. One's first reaction in such a setting, I think, is to yield to the temptation of ranking the performances. Which do I like best? Which do I like least? All that kind of thing. A second is to cherry pick, saying, I like this version from version A, this feature from version A, and this detail from version B. I'll use what I like from each in creating my own performance. Only later does one realize that each performance stems from a coherent worldview that deserves to be taken seriously and appreciated as a whole. It is this trajectory that the following remarks will pursue. At the outset, I must acknowledge that a great performance can make a crucial difference in the understanding and appreciation of a work. But a trap lies in thinking that the starting point in comparing performances is to determine which performance is better than another. A tried and true method of demonstrating this fallacy is to juxtapose performances of the same piece made in different generations. Here's the beginning of the fourth movement of Beethoven's String Quartet, Opus 131. First, in a performance by the Capet Quartet from the 1920s that features a free use of portamento, or sliding from one note to the next, and then in one by the Takash Quartet made in recent years. Both are expressive, extremely expressive, in their own way, yet the second completely avoids, at least in this passage, the way of being expressive that is at the core of the first. Both in a row, Jay. Another contrast comes in two accounts of Liszt's transcription of the Schubert song, Hark, Hark, the Lark. We'll start with the current pianist, Evgeny Kisin, who plays with sparkling technique and musical sensitivity. Recording from the 1923 actually, it's an acoustical recording, by Ignaz Friedman, gives an entirely different picture of the piece. Here the focus is not that this is a transcription by Liszt, which means for many people an invitation to lots of notey virtuosity, but that there is a beautiful melody that needs to be given pride of place. Toward that end, not only is the non-melodic material kept at a volume and texture that permit remarkable dynamic variety and gradation in the melody, but rhythmic flexibility permits beguiling melodic inflections. Here's Friedman. It will not do, however, to portray all differences between performers and performances as stemming from generational differences. In fact, there exist at all times numerous valid ways of interpreting any given piece of music, all of them justified by the information, instructions, and implications the score and scholarship provide. Our next example features the first movement of Haydn's Symphony No. 97. The conductors are Roger Norrington and Nicholas Harnoncourt. Both of them made their names in the middle of the century and latter part of the century, of the 20th century, by leading ensembles that used historical instruments and thereafter moved on to mainstream orchestras, willing to adopt some of what they had learned and developed in that historical performance setting. These two performances were both made with such modern orchestras and recorded in 2009 and 2003, respectively. But the differences between them are significant. Norrington's landmark set of Beethoven symphonies from the 1980s was famous, even infamous, for trying to adhere faithfully to Beethoven's metronome markings, whatever the incongruities or strange issues that arose. Here, in a composer who predates the metronome, he adopts the same kind of aesthetic approach, allowing metronomic regularity to be the foundation for tightly coiled rhythms, precise articulation, and finely etched dynamic details. Harnoncourt, by contrast, sees this music as an opportunity for exploring shapes and gestures that take in larger units than individual beats. Although the notes are the same, one almost has to ask whether both of these pieces are by Haydn, so different is their effect. We'll do both of these in a row, Jay.
That was Norrington, now Harnoncourt. Mm-hmm.
As our last piece of contrast, I'd like to choose a composition that would seem to have less room for divergence. A 20th century piano piece, toccata-like, inviting the performers to show the full extent of their capabilities as athletic virtuosos. This is the last movement of Prokofiev's Piano Sonata No. 7, and I will play three performances of it, partly to give you a small taste of immersive listening, but mostly to make the point that, different as these three accounts are, I would not want to be without any of them, and that my view of the piece would be impoverished if any of them had not come to my attention. Let me provide you with a quick roadmap of the piece: an opening A section, a B section that features fanfares against a rhythmically active but harmonically static background, a C section that begins with a plunge into the lower registers but continues with hints of lyricism, then a return to the B material that serves as a transition to the return of A, which unfolds much as before but requires that the hands be thrown around more in the climactic passage and adds a coda filled with pandemonium. First, let's hear Maurizio Pollini from the 1970s. This is a famous recording, but it is definitely a recording, one made with all the skills in editing available at the time, so that the performance is note perfect at a prodigious rate of speed. The insider scoop on this recording is that Pollini spent about 3 weeks of 8-hour days recording this and the Petrushka pieces of Stravinsky for one particular album, and you don't need
you know, you have you don't need that much time to play the pieces, but you need that much time in order to assemble a performance that sounds this good. For a greater sense of reality, it's important to move to a performance by Vladimir Horowitz, given in 1953 as the final encore in his last concert before a 12-year hiatus in performing live recitals. So here's Horowitz. And finally, here is Sviatoslav Richter in a live performance from in London from 1970. Richter was chosen by Prokofiev to give the first performance of this sonata.
Thank you.
honest is the best, you know. Pollini's recording may be an artificial product, but it suggests a tantalizing ideal of speed and accuracy. Horowitz, by beginning with aristocratic ease, finding room for much local detail, and achieving especially desperate pandemonium at the end, gives the feeling of having undertaken an especially eventful journey. Richter's sense of direction, structural integrity, and concentrated process of intensification all give the piece an inevitable feeling that ennobles it. All three of these performances offer valuable perspectives on the work. None tells the whole story about it. So now we come to spelling out, I'm afraid not as clearly as I would like, the analogy I would like to propose. For this purpose, I ask that you choose a realm of human activity, like religion, or law, or politics, or social policy, as an area against which to test what I have to say. There are three images I would like to offer. First, if one takes seriously the implications of these multiple version exercises we've just been through, there is no such thing as a definitive performance. A solution that works perfectly in one setting can seem strained, beside the point, tasteless, or even wrong in another. Frank Kermode has made the point that any coherent interpretation of a rich and complicated text, like a musical score, or a Shakespeare play, or the Bible, practices a grandiose neglect of portions of the text. That is, there's much more to any such text than can be realized in one coherent package. Further, as soon as one has ceded authority to the definitive performance, it has become an idol that keeps us from having to engage productively with the ideas and people around us. Second, and somewhat related to the definitive performance fallacy, is the performer as critic syndrome. As musicians, you all know that in order to give a convincing performance, you need to have confidence and be sure of yourself. Not only should you know the notes you are expected to play or sing, but you should know how you are to perform them and why. If you do all this, your confidence will draw in the audience and make the performance an effective or even memorable one. If, however, you judge all other performances according to the decisions you have made in developing your interpretation, several things have gone wrong. You have doomed yourself to perpetual disappointment with others. You have forgotten Kermode's observation and the implication that other coherent interpretations can be assembled from portions of the text, whether that be play, scripture, or law, that you have left on the cutting room floor, and you have lost sight of the fact that even your own best efforts are inevitably provisional. If you work your way to a solution, then stick with it through thick and thin. You have ceased to examine your assumptions and have forgotten that when you were making your performance decisions, you were rejecting valid options, an inevitable occurrence, since at any given moment you can only do it one way. Learning to perform effectively is important, but once you have done so, learning the humility necessary to appreciate what others do in the same work or realm can be a challenge. The third image I'd like to leave with you comes from Richard Rohr. In Falling Upwards, A Spirituality for the Two Halves of Life, he suggests that in order to get a good start on life, one needs a container that provides certainty and a solid place to stand, but that until those certainties break down, until the container breaks, there is no room for growth. My container broke, musically speaking, when I learned to reject the definitive performance fallacy and to no longer participate in the performer as critic syndrome. I regard it as one of the great achievements of my life that I have come to genuinely appreciate and respond to recorded performances to which I once had a viscerally negative reaction. I did this by moving beyond feeling that my task in evaluating was to jump immediately to, do I like this or not? and instead to seek out and consider the legitimate issues and perspectives a performance contains. At this stage of life, I find nothing more enjoyable than listening to a performance of a piece of music I know intimately, being fully aware of the interpretive options at every point, and engaging with the performance as it travels through the familiar but ever-challenging terrain. I have found that something new and stimulating will unavoidably emerge from the performer's interaction with the score, as well as from my interaction with the interpretation. As I have grown older, it has increasingly been my attempt to transfer this ability and enjoyment in musical realms to non-musical realms as well. It is my hope that, again, in non-musical realms, you will all learn to rejoice in finding growth through the breaking of your container, rather than to doggedly pursue either a definitive performance from outside yourself or an ideal performance of your own creation. Understanding why others do what they do and appreciating them for it is an important step to getting along in this world, especially in our deeply polarized society of today. I am grateful that music, in addition to all the other gifts it has provided for me, has given me a way of working at that understanding. May it be so for you as well. Thank you.
I did end up taking the whole time, but if anyone wants to ask questions or engage in dialogue, I'm glad to do that too. We can do it publicly for a few minutes maybe, but after that you can come up here. So, thank you.
Does anyone have a question they'd like to ask Dr. Breckbill? Anybody?
David, the students that currently go here, put together a little shadow box for you. Actually, it was Emily Vogel's idea. She stole off of the door over there. I meant she took when they redid the building. She took the room 22, which is the room you normally taught in all the years, and she put into a shadow box here. Here's the room 22 sign with Beethoven's Ninth Symphony behind it. A gift from all of the students to Dr. Breckbill. Dr. Breckbill.
Okay, thank you so much. If you gave me this score on a quiz, I would recognize it. Thank you.
Why am I not surprised? do you want anybody to come up here and talk to you?
Sure. Is the stage free?
The stage is free.
Great.
So everyone, there is refreshments courtesy of NAFME out in the lobby. You're welcome to go there. If anybody would like to come and greet Dr. Breckbill, you can come up on the stage and do that. We are dismissed. Thank you.
5, okay, let's do it. 5, 1, 5, 1, 5, 3, 2, 1.
Wait, start over.
5, 1, 5, 1, 5, 3, 2, 1, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 5, 4, 3, 5, 1, 5, 1, 5, 3, 2, 1, 7, 6, 7, 1, 2, 2, 5. five, seven, one, six, five, six, seven, one, six, five, five, two, seven, two, seven, two, seven, five, four, three, two, one, seven, six, five, three, two, one, one, six, two, seven, five, five, three, three, one, six, two, seven, five, five, one. Remember not to breathe on the bar lines.
Thank you. We're dismissed. Howdy.
Thanks for coming.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Hey, thanks for coming.
Thanks for doing this.
Sure.
For letting us know about it.
You bet.
Loved it.
Good. Man.
I wanted to rush up here. I have a booster meeting at 6 o'clock. And
back where you are, yeah.
Yes, so
okay, good.
We split,
well, nice to see you.
Sure,
yeah, thanks so much.
Hi,
yeah. Okay. Well, good luck to both of you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, I very much enjoyed it, and it articulated so many beliefs that I have that I had in a poignant way that I hadn't thought about before.
Good. Good.
So, yeah. Great.
All right. Good. Well, yep. I hope it's helpful. Okay. See you later.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah.
Bye. Hey, how are you?
How are you?
I hear you're at Iowa.
I am, yeah.
The real pipeline there, huh?
They keep pumping them out, I guess.
Uh-huh,
it's
uh-huh.
The latest.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So what's your current, your first year, second year of a doctoral program?
Second year in the DMA program. So I'll be ABD. I'm on schedule to be ABD after the spring.
Do you have a topic for your document?
Well, I'm bouncing around a couple of ideas. They're floating, they're piloting some programs for performing and recording options. But what I'm really, the last month or so, I've been kicking around in my mind a lot is using jazz standards and sort of the American Jazz Songbook as a teaching tool within the classical voice studio as a means to learn to textually interpret art music, because as a jazz singer, you have an added layer, but you're still expected, you have to deal with a text, but you're still expected to improvise profusely.
Right, right.
And so if you can do that in the context of jazz, you know, it's obviously in other styles of music, you're not always allowed to change the notes and the rhythms.
But
Sometimes you
should go back and listen to all those old historical recordings of all the opera singers and stuff.
I wrote a short piece for Dr. Miriam Wilson Kimber?
I know the name.
She's
at
Iowa. She's a Mendelssohn scholar. I took a class with her, and I wound up writing a piece about improvisation within bel canto arias. And of course, there's lots of opportunities but anyway, that's one idea I'm kicking around. Otherwise, some sort of lecture.
Good.
But,
great. And what have you been singing lately?
Right.
Any
now,
big opera roles?
Yeah, a lot of opera roles. Last semester, I gave a recital, sang. It was a sacred recital that I had hoped to have right around Holy Week, but I missed that. Wound up doing it in May, but it was the Confutatis from the Verdi Requiem. From the Verdi Requiem, and then I did four vignettes from the St. Matthew Passion, the four bass arias, and then preceded that by the tenor narrative for each one, and then did the Vaughan Williams' five mystical songs, and closed with a Gounod melody.
Cool.
And
it's really great to see you, but also to hear you, because your voice has developed since I knew you. You know.
Yeah. I hope so.
Well, thank you so much for coming.
Absolutely. I wouldn't miss it.
Yeah,
so,
good.
Thank you.
David, a group of us are going out to eat at Pizza Hut after this. If you wanted to join us, you could.
Okay.
You want me to
check it with Anita,
all right,
yeah.
Great,
see what
great.
She thinks.
I'll
hey,
good
thanks
to see
for
you.
Coming.
Yeah, of course. I just have a quick question for
you.
Having lived the life that you've lived knowing all the things you know, what would you say is your favorite piece in existence?
I can't answer that question.
Really?
I have 3,000. You know?
That was kind of my question.
Yeah. No, I mean, there are many that mean a lot to me. And as I say, the biggest thing that has been nourishing to me in recent years is if you know all these pieces really well, you can turn on any one of them and enjoy what the performer is doing with it. You know, that's the source of the enjoyment as opposed to the piece itself. I mean, how would you distinguish between Mahler's second and Mahler's ninth? How can you say one is more favorite than the other?
Right.
I mean, you know, what conceivable criterion would be able to cover a justified response to that question, you know? And if you can't do it for two pieces, how can you do it for, you know?
For the entire
Yeah.
That was kind of, my question was like similar. If you could assign the world one piece of music to study.
And really, it's not Beethoven's Ninth. I mean, but that just happens to be a handy one for certain pedagogical purposes, but yeah, right. Yeah, so, I don't know. I'm sorry to be so unhelpful, but you know, that's just the way my answer comes out, you know.
That makes sense.
Thank you for your insight.
Yeah, sure.
And thanks for coming out today.
Sure, yeah. Great to appreciate it. Thanks for all your stuff.
Where's your favorite place in India?
Favorite place in India? Well, I don't know.
My favorite question is a bad one. What is a place to stop? I'm going to India in January.
You are?
Yes.
Well, we spent our time in Pune.
Okay.
And I really loved up in Dharamsala, where the Dalai Lama hangs out. And we had a good time down in Kerala. So those are all places that I've been that I could recommend.
Can we get a picture with you, three of us?
Sure.
With you,
the crew.
Our favorite professor.
The crew.
Do you remember when I used
our
to cry during
this? I love music history. This way, they are my favorite.
This way, probably.
Okay. We'll just hang out behind you, like the scary family picture.
That's perfect.
Thank you, Dr. B.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for everything.
Could you take a quick picture of us before you go?
You're the best, Dr. B.
See ya.
Thanks for making me finish my music. Okay. Which side do you want me on?
Don't care.
I'll go on this side. That way the lighting is a little bit better. I'm just going to sneak in there. Or not. There we go.
Sorry.
Okay.
Oh, thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah. Just wanted to say... Definitely wanted to have more classes with you. So.
Sorry it didn't work out, but I it's the right decision because I stopped last Wednesday and it's been steady decline since then. So it's just not going to work, you know. And so.
I was wondering if I could send you a card.
Sure.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I'll just have to track down your.
They have it, yeah.
Okay, yeah, but you've always been a huge inspiration to me, like. I always thought you were really brilliant. I really appreciated you teaching me how to read music my mm-hmm. first year.
Sure, good. So. Well, hang in there. You'll do well.
You're very special.
Yeah, okay. Thanks for everything.
Give me a hug.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you so much. Love you.
Okay, love you too. Hey, Elizabeth, how are you?
Good
to see you.
Yeah, good to see you too. Yeah. I just really wanted to say thank you. My third and fourth graders. Study the classical and romantic periods, and I use my notebook every day when
oh, great.
I teach them. And
wonderful.
I can't find the right words to say thank you so much.
Well, thank you. Yeah, it's. I think you know now that you're in that position, sort of the way I feel. It's just such a pleasure to share music with people. You know.
Yeah. So. Yeah, so thank you. I wouldn't be near the teacher I am if I hadn't had to.
Okay. Well, thanks for being here. Yeah. Thanks for making the effort to come. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Hey.
I'm gonna give you a hug.
Hey, Seth, how are you doing?
Good. Just want to say hi.
Hey, how are you doing, Levi?
Thanks for the lecture.
Sure. Good. Yeah, I still think I chose right being a pianist. I just love that. Love that music. Yeah.
It's great seeing you.
Yeah. So what's going on in your lives? Where are you? Still same place?
Yeah, same place.
Uh-huh. And what about you?
I'm in Lincoln. Playing music, reading, same things.
Okay. Nice. Good. Well, keep in touch. Yeah, good. Nice to see you. And thanks for making the effort to be here.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Always good.
Hey.
You made me think about a lot of things today.
Well,
I'm serious. I'm really serious.
Hope I didn't break a spring or something.
No, you didn't do that. We want a picture.
I'm supposed to be the photographer here. Okay.
Go take it.
Are we good?
Uh-huh.
I enjoyed your speech.
You gave me something to think about.
Good.
The rest of the week here.
Okay, good.
I'm serious about that, about the comparisons and things.
Uh-huh.
And that last piece, I don't know, but I feel like I do now.
Yeah.
You know
well, that's
I'm
an
saying.
Important piece for me.
I know the frosting on it now.
Yeah.
You know.
That's like a real tough E to me.
Oh, my word. It sounds impossible to play, but obviously it isn't.
It's like, you know, everything just goes totally pandemonium.
And the thing that's funny, of course, is that he writes the wrong notes in, right?
Right, so it just sounds like splat, you know?
It sounds like you're splatting, but those are the notes he writes.
Those are the right notes,
That Pellini was note perfect, you know?
I wouldn't want to have to choose one, so you made your point, you know?
Okay. Well, I have a secret favorite, but I won't tell you which.
Well, I think we know.
I love how Horowitz gets the total change of texture.
Oh, I know.
In the middle.
Yeah.
Jeez, that is just magical.
Yeah.
Flying here.
I know. He's circling around me. Yeah.
I love that.
Okay. See you later.
But go enjoy your party.
Huh?
I love that you picked the harp.
Oh.
That's an important piece for me.
That's a great piece.
When I was in college, I was intimate with a string quartet, the Delphi Quartet, and that was one of their pieces, and I just love that. That's one of the
that coda is
passages.
Amazing. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you were vintage.
Well, thank you so much. Hey, Rob. Thanks for coming. Yeah.
Thanks for doing this.
Yeah.
It's great.
Yeah.
I wish I had more of those, more of that from you.
Yeah.
You kind of epitomize what the place is all about, I think.
Well, I'd like to think so, yeah.
Liberal arts institution.
Yeah. Good. Well, thanks for coming.
Take care.
Yeah. We'll be in touch. Hey. How are things?
Good.
Good.
Good, good. Busy.
Yeah.
I wish I had more free time, but.
You did?
Doing well and enjoying what I'm doing, which is important, right?
Good, that's great.
So, yeah. I'm at Southeast High School now and head vocal director there. And you know,
keeps you busy.
And there were many nights where I remember your office light was on late.
Huh.
And you were, whether you were here or you were sending emails at 2 a.m.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, oh my gosh, no. And now I'm like 2 a.m. sending emails. So. Thanks for being a good representative of how to work
you bet.
At home.
That's, I guess, yeah.
Right. Yeah. So beautiful talk.
Okay, thanks. Thanks for coming.
Enjoy it.
Appreciate it.
Can Sam and I take a picture with you since you did our recital?
Oh, yeah.
Sam.
I was just thinking about that Wolf piece the other day, actually, that I never sang.
Oh.
That I wanted to sing so poorly.
Huh.
Liz, can you got it, Megan?
I got it. 1, 2. Take one from this angle,
got it.
Only because the light is really weird. 1, 2, 3.
It's very, very
bright.
Yeah.
Good to see you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Take it easy. Yeah. Thanks.
How are you? That's okay. We'll see you later.
How are you?
Good.
So I spent my last year in Taiwan listening to very different music than I'd ever heard before.
Right.
But I just feel like I was able to appreciate it faster.
Mm-hmm. That's what musical skills will do for you, yeah.
Yeah, that's true. But it was just bizarre, all of it. At first, it was like, I just didn't even know how to start comprehending the sounds of it. But anyway, I feel like I got skills because of it.
Good. Great. Thanks so much. Yeah, thanks for coming.
Great talk.
Yeah, you got it. Thanks.
Hi.
Thanks for your card. Yeah, that was nice. Yeah.
Of course, I think of you often. My kids love Beethoven.
Good.
They love the old dead guy of the month.
Good.
So I've had to start choosing alive composers because, you know, they assumed you had, you know, to be Beethoven or Bach to be a composer. So they love it, though.
Good.
Mussorgsky was this month. Night on Bald Mountain. Sousa is this month. All good things.
Good.
It's very
well, they're not alive either.
No, they're not. So I'm choosing, who did I do, though? Who did I do? It wasn't Eric Whitaker, it was a choral composer. Oh, we did John Williams. They were very, very fascinated. So Star Wars. they were very, very excited
about.
You
missed the look that Krista and I gave each other because you said, a choral composer, I did a choral, John Williams.
No, I did someone choral. I can't remember who it was. I think it was Eric Whittaker for the last year. Yeah, it's good stuff.
Cool.
They're adorable. They are appreciative. So thank you.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Yeah. Hey, how are you? Good to see you. Oh, that's okay. Thanks.
Amazing to see you.
Nice to see you. Thanks for coming.
Wouldn't miss it for the world.
Good.
Thank you for everything that you taught me.
Yeah, well.
And all the stuff that I forgot as well that I'll remember
right,
someday.
Right, right. But the good thing is that if you immerse yourself in something, you're doing what I did, you know? So that's the important thing to do.
And so, Dr. Breckbill, you need to tell me what the name of the 5-1 song is.
Die kleine Spinnerlein by Mozart. It's a little lead song by him. Yeah, and it's I found it in a sight singing book, but it filled that particular level in what we needed to cover, and so I've used it pretty frequently. So, yep.
It was great to see you, Dr.
Yeah, nice to see you. Take it easy.
Amazing talk.
Thanks. Okay. Hey, Leanne, how are you?
I'm wonderful.
Good to see you.
Yeah. I wanted to make sure I gave this.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
And tell you how much I miss music history class.
Oh, yeah. It's fun to do those classes.
I didn't know how much I remember from Beethoven until I started tutoring some of the FAR students this year. I'm like, oh, I can sing this part. And, wow, it's so much fun.
Well, and then that's a testimony to them that, you know, if you work at it, it'll sink in and be useful. Yeah.
And they're already getting so much out of it. I'm like, all the stuff they're reminding me of that I may have forgotten in between time, but... It's awesome.
Yeah,
I just
good.
Wanted to say yeah. Thank you. And
so is your recital coming okay?
It is.
Who's playing for you?
Fei-Fei.
Okay.
I haven't gotten to see her much. She injured her finger.
Didn't hear that.
Yeah, so hopefully next month we're going to, well, end of this month now. It's November already, but we're going to start into working on it.
Good. Well, I hope it goes well.
Yeah, I let the Creston go for this year.
Oh, you did?
Yep, I'm doing, I'm not doing Glazunov this time, so... But this should be good.
Okay, great.
Well, thank you.
Well, good luck with everything. Okay, thanks. Yeah. Hey, how are you?
Good to see you.
Hey.
Here we are.
So now I have the deep dark secret. Oh, hi, Diane.
Hi.
The deep dark secret to ask you, who did you like best in the Prokofiev? Oh my gosh. Aren't they all amazing?
The Horowitz one.
Uh huh. You never heard that one?
No, oh, really? Uh-huh. I loved it. Some of the colors, well,
yeah.
That's
yeah, 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 yeah.
All those cool colors that he had.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know
so,
what?
Richter is probably your favorite, right?
Probably Secret, Deep Dark Down.
See,
yeah,
okay.
Right. But yeah, but all of them are so amazing, you know.
They're
yeah.
amazing. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know what came to mind?
I'll get a picture of you.
Oh,
all.
Okay. What came to my guys? What came to mind when I listened to that recording? Dr. Breckbill was a maniac.
Oh, yes. That's right.
That's
right.
What came to mind.
That was
picture.
That piece, wasn't it?
No, it wasn't. No, it was in the Lutoslavsky.
Oh,
the
okay.
Yeah.
Remember that? Yeah. Oh my gosh, I couldn't play the first note of that.
We're forcing you to pose for a picture here.
All right.
Oh, always.
It comes natural.
Bill, do you mind doing one with my phone?
Not at all.
There we are. And you can adjust it however you want just by this way.
Oh, okay. Cool. Yeah, I probably need the wide.
Yeah, maybe so.
Oh.
Look sharp, Emmy.
There we go. That seems to be a little better.
Bill's taking a panoramic
picture. Well, that spotlight.
Were,
is right.
Were we all getting halos? Or?
Well, Emmy has a halo in one of them.
Thank oh, really? Well, no, it's not the spotlight.
No,
it's natural.
Yeah, of course.
It's gonna be one of those panoramic pictures where you know you just go like that, you see everybody from all angles.
Oh, there we go. Oh yeah. But,
this is hilarious.
It's hilarious. Is it?
Yeah, there's a, like a sunbeam coming in here.
All the right
it
notes.
Looks like Diane's about to beam up to the Enterprise or something.
Oh boy.
There we go. We'll get a vertical.
Oh, okay.
There we go.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
So I got your note about getting together, and I'd love to do that. I just get so tired. So it's hard to know how to plan necessarily. This next weekend, a whole bunch of my family from both sides are sort of descending on us. So that's going to be a busy and exhausting time. I'll just have to see and let you know. Maybe if it doesn't work to go out somewhere, you could all drop by at a certain time or something like that.
Why don't you tell us? Because we'll then
proceed. So how would it be maybe if we said a weekend, and then we just knew that sometime on the weekend, you just call us when you would feel up to having us stop by, and we could just kind of do it that way, you know, kind of just identify a framework, you know, and then whatever works for you.
I can try that.
And we'll come to your house.
Yeah, sure.
Sounds good.
Like on a given Saturday.
Yeah.
Because Sunday is church.
Yeah, we could do a Saturday based on, you know, time.
Okay. Well, we'll.
Whatever.
Works about, yeah.
That's right. Yeah. So,
where is my will be waiting.
Okay. Good. Okay, thanks for coming. Yeah,
right.
Good. Well, you know, it was. Good. Well, I hope you found it that way.
You're doing even more listening now than you have before?
No.
Oh, okay.
That's been a pretty constant thing in my life, yeah.
Yeah.
It has been.
Yeah.
But I thought since you don't have teaching responsibilities,
yeah, but a lot of napping goes on too, so yeah.
Right.
That's true.
So.
I need to listen more. See, after hearing you now, I'm going to go home and find all my recordings of things and start listening more.
Okay.
You get busy with everything, you know.
Well, yeah.
And I have to make that time.
I have been blessed that not only have I wanted to, but I've basically been able to find the time to do all this listening because of various things. So
I've always marveled at that.
Yeah. And the
found the time to write. And
part of it is just, you know, dividing. If you have a professional life that demands that you listen, then you have two birds killed with one stone, you know?
Sure.
So,
That's right. Exactly.
So, good. Great. Well, thanks again for coming.
Great to see you.
We'll be awaiting your call.
Okay, thanks.
We'll just wait to hear from
you. I'll call one of you and have the other one.
Okay, sounds good.
Okay, sounds good. Okay, bye.
Thanks,
hey.
Thanks
for coming.
You?
Doing
Thank
okay.
You.
Good. Hey.
How are you?
Doing okay.
It's good to
nice
see
to see you.
I'm so glad I could make it.
Good.
Yeah.
I'm glad you did. Yeah. It's nice.
I told Amy I really regret that I never got to take one of your classes because I wasn't technically a music major. And now I could be using it to the extent.
Well, I'm really glad I came because my son is graduating this year from high school. And I'm feeling it, and I don't know what to do for the rest of my life. And so I might just turn into a serial immersion. I'm serious, because I really don't know.
Sure. Well, that's a good. You could do worse things,
yeah.
I think. Yeah.
Anyway,
good. Okay. Good luck. Okay. Hey, how are you? So one class down with the new teacher. Did that go okay? She's nice. Yeah.
She was nice. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
It's gonna take us a while to all get on the same page.
Sure. Yeah.
It'll be fine.
Yeah. Good.
She
good.
Seems to know what she's doing.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
So, yeah, it's gonna be fine. But yeah, it's just interesting. New.
To switch horses midstream. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
No, it'll be. We'll make it
midstream.
Work. Yeah. But yeah. It's
good.
Thank you for coming and doing this talk.
You bet. Well, I had put it on the calendar earlier in the semester and decided I needed to just persist until it happened.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, no, it was really great.
But, you know, I want you to know that, you know, I made the decision to stop sort of reluctantly, but it was the right decision because I've been not doing as well since then. So it's...
Yeah, no, you gotta do what's right for you. And
yeah.
We appreciate you so much for even coming this semester at all.
Yeah.
I mean, it's
yeah.
a lot. So.
Well, and I didn't say this in so many words, but one of my main reasons for coming back this semester was just to bring your class, you know, into Harbor, you know, and so that you didn't have to undergo a change in approach and that kind of thing. But there are worse things. You, this way you get more more perspectives on things, so it'll be fine.
Thank you for coming for as long as you did.
Sure, okay. Good, well, good luck. Okay, take it easy.
Yeah. Thank you.
I'm wearing a backpack. I have to take it off.
Okay.
Thanks a lot. Thank you so much.
You bet. Thanks. Hey, how are you? Thanks for your note. That was great.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Just touched a lot of people. Good. We're going to go out to eat. And we didn't really have too much class time together, but what little we did have really touched them.
Good.
You said that your goal with playing all those little music snippets in class was to try to spark that interest in the students. And for me, it wasn't really the music that sparked it, but just your passion for all that music and your passion for us that really sparked my desire to go out and learn more.
Well, good. Well, I'm glad.